It is my privilege to introduce to you our next speaker. He's really a Filipino whose exceptional accomplishment have brought pride to our country, exemplifying the talent and dedication for which Filipinos are widely recognized. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Applied Physics from the University of the Philippines and has served as a professor teaching college algebra and physics in Mindoro State University. In 2006, he transitioned his career into software development by joining the UP Information Technology Center, or the UP IDDC, where he successfully completed a certificate program in information technology. After accumulating 7 years of experience in software development in both here in the Philippines and in Japan, he relocated to Perth, Australia in 2015. There, he eventually became part of Moodle HD. Since starting his career with Moodle in 2015, he has become the integration lead of Moodle HQ for Moodle LMS. He is primarily responsible for overseeing and integration and release processes of Moodle LMS, ensuring that the upcoming version are released on schedule and maintain the highest quality. He leads a team of senior HQ developers known as integrators, ensuring that bug fixes, improvements, and new feature contributions are secure and on the highest quality before being integrated into the Moodle LMS codebase. In addition to this integration responsibility, he has also participated actively to accessibility initiative of Moodle LMS. He focuses particularly on addressing and resolving accessibility issues identified during Moodle LMS regular accessibility audit. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in extending a warm welcome to Mr. Jun Pataleta.
Hello, yeah, this is better. Hi, I hope you guys are awake. Hi. So yeah, hello everyone. My name is Jun Pataleta. I'm the integration lead for Moodle LMS at Moodle HQ. Today, I would like to present how vital the community is to Moodle success and how you can contribute to it. So first, I would like to introduce myself. Although yeah, a lot of things I like have been mentioned by Sir Roy already. But yeah, as I mentioned before, my name is Jun. But given that we're mostly Filipinos here, can I get a raise of hands if you believe that my legal name is Jun? No. And you're correct, because it's my nickname. It's derived from the junior of Lorenzo Junior. Although in Australia, it's a bit weird. My name gets usually mispronounced in like Florencio, like that. So it's funny and cringy at the same time. It's also what my mother calls me when she's mad. So let's just stick to June, okay? I grew up in Oriental Mindoro. It's an island south of Manila, basically. So for those who don't know, there you go. I decided to put them up as well because not just for our foreign delegates, but because I've met people who thought that Mindoro is in Mindanao, which is the southernmost island in the Philippines. Although when I tell them that Mindoro is, when I tell them that Puerto Galera is in Mindoro, they suddenly get it, so just weird. Yeah. So I, like Sir Roy mentioned, I graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree in Applied Physics from the University of the Philippines. However, I decided to make a career change to IT in 2006 because I decided not to pursue graduate studies in physics. It's really hard. I barely finished on time, so got to find another passion to pursue. So my shift to IT began with a one-year certificate in IT program offered by the UP IT Training Center in partnership with the Japan International Cooperation Agency, or JICA at that time. It was the first time I used Moodle when one of our teachers uploaded our course materials to a Moodle site. So during that time, I got a scholarship from a Japanese company, and they hired me after I graduated from the program. The weird thing is that my specialization in UPI-TTC was network systems. So when I started at the company, I expected to design network topologies or set up computer networks, but I ended up working on software development instead. So, okay, fine. So, but it's funny how things work out, because if not for that unexpected shift to software development, I wouldn't eventually become a Moodle developer and wouldn't have the honor and privilege of standing here and delivering this presentation to you. Cool. So I moved to Perth in Western Australia in 2015. And after getting my permanent resident visa, I started looking for work and got the opportunity to work at Moodle HQ. Moodle already has a global presence at that time. But I did not expect Moodle HQ to be a tiny company. We only had like 20 staff, less than 20 staff in Perth. And Martin Lugian, Moodle's founder and CEO at the time, was even one of the people who interviewed me. So it was really a kind of a nerve-wracking experience. But yeah, thankfully, it turned out okay. So yeah, Moodle was a much smaller company at that time. So I'm 99% sure that I'm the first Filipino HQ developer in Moodle's history. 1%, I'm just leaving 1% in case it's fake news. Okay, well yeah, I'd also like to share that a few days after receiving my job offer at Moodle HQ, I got my Western Australian driver's license after 3 tries. Yeah, yes, I failed my driving exam in Perth twice. It was quite a frustrating and a bit depressing experience because I had 16 years of driving experience in the Philippines. And I believe that in the saying that if you can drive in Manila or in the Philippines, you can drive anywhere in the world. But no, that's not true. Apparently, by Australian standards, my driving skills sucked. Yeah, so that experience became like a core memory for me. So sharing the story about the time I got hired by Moodle HQ kind of goes hand in hand with the story about getting my driver's license. So yeah, in 2017, I joined the integration team for Moodle LMS. And I'd like to briefly describe Moodle's development process. So when an issue in the Moodle tracker gets opened and triaged and someone works on the patch for the issue will go through the initial peer review stage. If it passes the peer review stage, it will be sent to integration review. At this stage, this is where the integrators come, where we do the final review of the code contribution. The code contribution can usually come from HQ developers or from the community, from like developers from universities or developers from Moodle partners. So if the patch is good enough, we will integrate it to the integration repository. It's not on the diagram, but an issue can also be sent to the component lead review stage. So the component lead review stage is a form of a final review as well, but it's done by component leads. And these component leads are like, they're the ones in charge for certain components within the Moodle platform. They don't have push capabilities to our integration repository. Only integrators have the privilege to do that. So once they approve the fix to be integrated to Moodle Codebase, the integrators also get a final look, get a final quick skim of the contribution, and then if there's something that stands out, you just push it to the integration repository. Then it will go to testing. If testing is good enough, the issues in the tracker is finally considered closed and will be part of the main Moodle repository. So to summarize, integrators are HQ developers who perform a final review of code contributions to Moodle LMS. So currently we have 7 integrators on the team. There's only 5, but yeah. The ones in Australia include myself, Andrew, Ilya, Jake, and Shamim. And we also have Wong in Vietnam and Sara from Spain. The integration team ensures that the code integrated into Moodle Core is of the highest quality, because there are like several ways to fix a problem. So we want the best solution to land into Moodle Core. So we also have Shamim on the team. He is mainly responsible for monitoring the status of automated tests from issues that are sent to integration review. He also organizes our QA cycle in every major release. So the integration team also relies heavily on automation in our CI infrastructure. And we develop and maintain our various sub-products and tools which help us and other Moodle developers ensure the quality of the code contributions that we integrate into the Moodle code base. We have Eloy from Spain, who mainly takes care of this aspect. And just a fun fact, Eloy is our former integration lead. He was one of the first Moodle developers when the company started, and he has been like the integration lead since the formation of the integration team more than 10 years ago. In 2022, he decided to step back from the integration lead role to focus on his passions, such as coding, research, experimentation, and developing and improving our sub-products. So the integration lead role opened up, and I put my hand up for it and got the role. So after I signed the role change letter, I asked Eloy, has any other integrators put their hand up? And he was like, no, you're the only one who put their hand up. So you may be wondering if I'm brave or stupid for taking on the role. Let's just think I'm brave, okay? But yeah, kidding aside, even with the challenges and pressure that come with the role, I'd say that it's been pretty okay, because we already have like pretty much defined processes in the integration team. And we keep refining these processes over the years. And most importantly, I know I can rely on the team for the input and support. Yeah, so I guess that's a very long introduction to tell you how my work is directly connected to the development of Moodle LMS and how we interact with the Moodle community. So basically, as we know, Moodle LMS is the most popular and open source learning management system, and is also the reason why we are here. As all of us know, Moodle LMS is the heart of the Moodle ecosystem. From the passionate minds that support Moodle, the Moodle community was formed. It's composed basically of users like administrators, teachers, course creators, students, partners, institutions, and organizations and developers. So the community grew, Moodle also got better. And as Moodle's scale grew and technologies evolved, we were also able to develop more products and services based on the Moodle platform, such as the Moodle mobile apps, Moodle Cloud, Moodle Workplace, among others. By the time I wrote this slide, there were around 161,000 registered Moodle sites worldwide. In the Philippines, we have about 1,210 registered sites. From the site registrations, around 411 million lifelong learners have used Moodle at some point. But if we could count the users of those unregistered sites, we believe it would be a far more considerable number than this official number. These numbers are not just a testament to Moodle's global success, they also reflect the support that the community provides in this success. Cool, the power of the community. Here in the Philippines, we have the concept of Bayanihan. Can you raise that, your hands if you know Bayanihan? Of course, Filipinos, yay! So, the concept of Bayanihan is where the community comes together to help each other or someone in need. The most common visual illustration of Bayanihan is a group of community members carrying a traditional Filipino house and moving it to another place. So, by the way, I generated this using Copilot's AI that uses DALL-E. So I asked the AI to create an image based on the Filipino concept of Bayanihan. So this is one of the images that I found somehow acceptable. Although if you notice, there's a bit of an oddity here, because one person is like moving almost the group. I don't know what the AI is thinking. Maybe he's thinking the man just wants to help carry the house while walking backwards, or maybe he composes the group and wants to move the house to a different location. So I don't know. Just use your imagination, okay?
Same license.
Sorry for that off topic.
And also,
the act of Bayanihan, by literally carrying houses, is not very common nowadays, because in the Philippines, houses are now usually made up of concrete or wooden structures that are permanently fixed underground. But the spirit of Bayanihan is still very much alive in these modern times, especially in times of crisis. And the Moodle community reminds me of Bayanihan on a global scale. And if we are to name the top two reasons why Moodle has such a global presence, it would be the following. First, Moodle is free and open source. Anyone can download and install Moodle LMS at no cost, and they get an enterprise-grade learning management system, which is secure by design, protects its users' data, and is fully customizable. That's a great deal, right? And second, it has an active and diverse global community that brings out Moodle's potential in ways that exceed even HQ's imagination. This is the power of the community that the community brings to Moodle, and I will discuss this in the next few slides. So, being an open source project, Moodle LMS has received a lot of improvements, new features, and bug fixes from the community. So, we just released Moodle 4.4 last month. Of the 812 issues that we integrated during that 6-month-long development cycle for Moodle 4.4, 174 came from around 65 community developers around the world. That's about 21% of the bug fixes, new features, and improvements that landed in Moodle 4.4. Moodle HQ employs about 31 core developers for Moodle LMS. That includes the integration team. If we do a rough estimate based on that percentage of community contributions for Moodle 4.4, it's equivalent to having eight additional full-time developers working for HQ in the past 6 months, but at no cost for Moodle HQ. This is a huge help to us in HQ, as it allows us to allocate more resources in the development of other items in our product roadmap. And more importantly for me, it's a prime example of the community's impact at work for an open source project. So, thanks, community. Yeah, in 2021, we celebrated the anniversary of Moodle's first source code commit by Martin. Since that first commit and Moodle's initial release in 2002, thousands of commit contributions from the community followed. Majority of these commit contributions to the Moodle code base come from educational institutions and Moodle partners. And to put it in numbers, from Moodle 1.0 to Moodle 4.4, over 1,000 developers from 60 countries worldwide have contributed over 145,000 code commits to Moodle. So basically, there are less than 100 current and former HQ developers since Moodle's initial release. So for me, it feels surreal that over 90% of these 1,000 developers who contributed to Moodle are from the community. So I find it simply amazing. Okay, now let's move on to translations. The Moodle community plays a significant role in making Moodle available in various languages worldwide. We write, so Moodle HQ and its contributors write Moodle in English. And translators from the Moodle community translate these English screens to their local language every time we release a new version of Moodle. As of Moodle 4.4, the community has translated about 2.7 million screens in 214 languages. There is no other LMS that comes close to this, and this is a massive advantage for Moodle LMS over other LMSs. And it's all thanks to the community. And yeah, I cannot emphasize enough how vital the community is to Moodle's success. But it's not just about the community helping develop and translate Moodle. It's also about what the Moodle community brings to the world of Moodle. So as an open source, fully customizable plugin and modular learning platform, Moodle developers can create plugins that expand the features of Moodle LMS. Many of these plugins are shared with Moodle, with the Moodle community via the Moodle Plugins Directory. So can I get a show of hands from people who know about the Moodle Plugins Directory? Yay. Quite a few. Yeah. So for those who don't know, the Moodle Plugins Directory is like an app store for Moodle plugins. When I wrote this presentation, there were 2,238 plugins in the Moodle Plugins Directory. The list of Moodle plugins keeps growing as HQ and select community members or plugin guardians review dozens of plugins each month for approval before they can get published in the Plugins Directory. So please note that majority of these plugins were developed by the community, and only a handful were developed or maintained by Moodle HQ. What's impressive about plugin developers from the Moodle community, besides developing and maintaining software for the community and usually for free, is that they expand Moodle's features beyond our imagination, which I will show you in the next few slides. So first, let me show you a screenshot of an example course in the plain version of Moodle 4.4. This uses the custom sections course format that comes by default in Moodle. We have refined the look and feel of Moodle over the years, especially the course homepage. The current version of the course homepage is simple, clean, and modern enough for course creators to create effective learning content. Do you agree? Yeah? Cool. But you know, the creativity of the Moodle community can bring online learning to a whole new level. So I'll show you another screenshot of a Moodle course. This is actually a Moodle course. So this image here is a screenshot of a premium Moodle course format plugin called Level Maps. It incorporates gamification for a more engaging learning experience. In a nutshell, the buildings represent the activities or resources within the Moodle course. What's cool about it is that it stimulates curiosity and invites the learners to explore the whole course. As the learners As the learner completes the activities, the buildings will grow until the forest looks like a big city. So what is a really cool plugin? It's not really something that Moodle HQ would prioritize developing, given there are other competing priorities and limited resources that we have. The community helps elevate the user's learning experience on Moodle. So yeah, as we know, AI surged in popularity in the past couple of years. It's even the theme of this MOOD. When I first learned about the theme of this MOOD, I was like, what did I talk about regarding AI? HQ is still in the early stages of building an AI subsystem. Moodle has the analytics subsystem but that uses machine learning, but I barely know anything about it. So when the AI subsystem for Moodle was still pretty much a to-do list for Moodle HQ, we already have plugins that use GenAI or generative AI in the plugins directory, all developed by the community. So I'd like to personally thank the Moodle community, especially the developers of these GenAI plugins. Because of you, I have something to talk about AI in my presentation. So, moving on to the next topic, we've got the Moodle Users Association as well, or Moodle MUA. Yesterday, Matt has touched on the project sponsored by MUA. So, do we have people here that are members of the MUA? Okay, so just to recap, the MUA is a community-driven organization that supports Moodle by funding the development of some of the new features of Moodle LMS. They have sponsored the development of new features and UX or UI improvements to Moodle since Moodle 3.1. Some of the recent features they have sponsored include the development of the bulk editing feature in the course homepage in Moodle 4.2. Have you seen this feature? No? Okay, so better update to 4.2 or later. And also for Moodle 4.4, as Matt mentioned, MUA sponsored the integration of the ordering question type. This question type plugin is a community developed plugin, mainly written and maintained by Gordon Bateson, who's a professor in Kochi University of Technology in Japan. So the MUA voted for this plugin to be integrated to Core, to Moodle Core, and then we at HQ provided UX, UI, and accessibility refinements to the plugin. So it's also amazing that the community can bring Moodle to places beyond our expectations. And with Moodle Bus, this is not just a metaphor, because you can literally bring Moodle anywhere. The Moodle Docs project is another community-driven project that provides a standalone Moodle installation that can be downloaded and installed on a Raspberry Pi. This means you can set up your course materials in a Moodle box, bring it to a remote area, and have your learners connect to it via its own Wi-Fi service. This provides a local online learning experience without the need for internet connectivity. If you have a battery pack and a solar panel, you could even run it without AC power. So I think that many remote communities in the Philippines can benefit from this. So we have some challenges too. So it's incredible that to have the support of a global community of learners, educators, administrators, and developers. However, there are also some challenges that come with this. So we know that various people to Moodle, making it so it makes it challenging to maintain a consistent UI across the whole platform. This is especially true in its earlier days. So for example, we have different variations of a confirmation message. This is how it looks on the chat activity. We have the confirmation message with the continue button on the right, and then we have the assignment, which has a continue button on the left, and then we have this wiki activity where the confirmation buttons are just yes or no. So it's, it's a bit tricky. So it's good that our processes have improved over the years, that our product and user experience team work hard to provide us guidance for a more consistent UI when developing newer features for Moodle. Another challenge is about keeping up to date. We always have to consider the community when introducing changes to Moodle so that we don't break the community plugins. As a result, we usually take a bit more time before we can adopt the latest trends in software development or even some of the external libraries that we use. Take Bootstrap, for example. So Bootstrap is the front-end framework that Moodle's default Boost theme uses. Moodle is still on Bootstrap 4. Bootstrap 5 has been released 3 years ago. So given that Bootstrap 5 has a significant leap, it's a significant leap from version 4, it has a lot of breaking changes. So we need to carefully plan to upgrade Bootstrap to Bootstrap 5 in step-by-step increments, just like this one. So if we don't do this, many community plugins, especially theme plugins based on the Boost theme, can break. And then there are many more challenges, but I would like to mention one more. It's great that we have such a diverse community. However, it's especially challenging when everyone has different opinions about how things should be done in Moodle. So for example, in 2021, we announced the redesign activity icons for Moodle 4.0 and asked the community for their thoughts. We got a lot of engagement from the community, but the discussion just kept going on and on and on with people throwing in their own ideas and icon designs. Even after we had already released 4.0, the forum posts and design just kept going on. So we had to try our best to get the community on board with the new icons. And such things take a lot of time sometimes, and a lot of patience as well. But at the end of the day, it's all worth it. The positives brought by the Moodle community simply outweigh all of these challenges. So I guess you should now know, you should have a pretty good idea of how you can contribute to Moodle and the Moodle community. So let's go to some of these ways. So with most of us here being non-native English speakers, one obvious thing we can do to contribute to Moodle is to translate it. So for example, Moodle has Tagalog language pack. And there's also a Philippine language pack that extends it. However, it needs some more love. As you can see, there's only like 22% of the language trees that have been translated to Tagalog. And a lot of these language trees are also out of date. So it would also be good if we can update or add better translations for languages, a language string that may sound weird. For example, this breadcrumb language string was updated in 3.5 to navigation bar. In 2.0, it's pakas ng mumo. Who knows what mumo is? Who knows? What's mumo? Sorry? Crumbs. Yeah, no. It's like leftover rice. Yeah, actually. So it sounds weird, especially if ghost, yeah, it's a ghost. Yeah, I heard. Sometimes it can mean ghost. It sounds weird because, people from Southern Tagalog usually know mumo as like rice, leftover rice. But in other Tagalog, it's like ghost. It can mean ghost, so we should update it. So yeah, so I hope you can help translate Moodle in Tagalog. So you can start contributing to Moodle translations by creating an account at logging in at land.moodle.org. So there's also a helpful page for newcomers to get you started. And we only have Tagalog and Filipino language packs in Moodle, but it doesn't mean that we can't add more. There are about 187 languages and dialects throughout the Philippine archipelago. Why not add a new language pack for Bicolano, Cebuano, Ilocano, Ilonggo, Pampangan, and Walay, and many more? If you create a new language pack, you can also become his maintainer. So when I was working on This Is Dice About Translation, I consulted with Helen Foster, our English Fixes language pack maintainer. She told me Moodle is special in that anyone is welcome to translate it into a minority language. This helps keep minority languages alive. That really resonated with me. Imagine if we could count, if we could translate Moodle into those 187 languages and dialects, we'd not only be able to help keep those languages alive, but we'd also be able to help preserve the culture behind those languages. So, can I get a show of hands from Moodle developers here? So in my 9 years with Moodle, I only recall interacting with a very few fellow Filipinos in the community, in the Moodle tracker. I wish more Filipino developers would actively contribute to Moodle development. So if you fix the Moodle specific bug on your Moodle site or implemented an improvement that would benefit Moodle and the community, please feel free to contribute to Moodle. And it's not that hard to get started, it's pretty easy. Just create an account at Moodle Tracker, at tracker.moodle.org. Even if you don't have a specific experience in Moodle development, if you know PHP, SQL, HTML, CSS, or JavaScript, it should be enough to get you started. All of it needs. So we use Git, and we have the developer resource center website at moodle.io to get you started. We also have a developer pathway course curriculum in Moodle Academy. But some of you might be thinking, June, I'm not a developer. Not so nerdy. But you don't have to be a developer to contribute to Moodle development. A lot of our participants in the tracker are not developers. If you simply report a bug or participate in the discussions, that's really a huge help for us. So if you're not a developer, you can also contribute to us from our QA testing. You can test the upcoming major version of Moodle during the QA testing period, which happens 4 to 6 weeks before the release. You may choose to test on our demo site or on your own local site. And once the next Moodle version gets released, you'll also get a nice little Moodle tester badge that will be displayed on your Moodle.org profile. It supports open badges, so you can upload it to your open badges backpack like badger.com. So there are also other ways to contribute. First, you can help shape the future of Moodle by joining the Moodle Experience Lab. Our user experience teams organize various user experience related activities such as design workshops, UX studies, research and surveys. Last year, Martin created the Moodle Research Lab. Its primary aim is to help lead Moodle towards a platform that not only anticipates future trends in technology and learning, but as a platform that does a better job of improving education for every individual. So Martin and the team perform research studies, conceptualizing and prototyping of new products that can help achieve this objective. So they work closely with the community through forums, surveys, and collaborative research to understand the long-term needs of Moodle and the community. So another one way to contribute to that is to simply engage in the Moodle forums. You can ask your questions or answer someone else's question. You can share your Moodle tips and even create a Filipino Moodle community, because we don't have a Filipino Moodle community yet. Of course, you can also share your Moodle plugins in the community. So by making your plugin available in the plugins directory, you can help solve the needs of other organizations. Just like in yesterday's presentation of Roy from Philippine Science High School on how the virtual programming lab activity plugin has helped solve his school's need for an effective way to manage the coding assignments of his students. So sharing your Moodle plugin to the employees directory is also a nice way of giving back to the to Moodle and the community. There are also options to contribute financially to Moodle. The most direct way is by going to moodle.org/donations and making a one-time or a monthly donation. And if your organization requires a specialized online learning solution that scales to your needs, just talk to a Moodle partner like Nefila Web. Moodle receives a portion of the Moodle partner's revenue from providing Moodle services through royalties, which helps fund HQ's development initiatives. So I just showed you the power of the community to drive growth and success to Moodle. Whether you have contributed to Moodle before or not, I hope my talk has inspired you to take pride in the fact that we all belong to this vibrant global community that makes a difference in education for a better world. If you have not yet contributed to Moodle, I hope my talk has inspired you to take action and contribute to the Moodle project. As cheesy as it may sound, you have the power to help shape the future of online education and significantly impact the lives of learners worldwide. So let's work together to make Moodle even better, even more inclusive, and more accessible to everyone. So yeah, before I finish, I would like to thank Nefila Webb and Ms. Cheryl and her wonderful team for having me here. It's really a privilege. Maraming salamat, everyone. Mabuhay tayo lahat.
Thank you very much, Mr. June Pataleta. Thank you also, sir, for sharing with us the power of community and how we can contribute to the Moodle community. So at this point, as you've said, if there are questions on the floor, you may now directly ask our speaker. Yes, ma'am, from table number 7. Can you please provide the mic to our delegate from table number 7?
Hello, good morning all. I'm Yomina Pavic from the Agricultural Training Institute. Actually, sir, my question is not about the community, but about the a product that you mentioned. Yung Moodle Box, sir. Is it available in the Philippines?
You can just download it. It is basically an image, like an image of a compact disc. If you think about it like that. Yeah. Then the Raspberry Pi is a hardware that you can buy anywhere. They have a recommendation for the specific Raspberry Pi version that would work well with the Moodle box image.
So follow-up question, is it available sa Nigeria? Yes, ma'am. We'll be happy to assist you on that.
Thank you. Okay, any other question? Yes, yes, sir, from table number 1.
Hello, once again. Sir, you know, Sir Ezekiel from Atinatinaga, Bicol. I'm very thankful to know more about you and how you work with the Moodle HQ, and especially your contributions. It's, for me, I salute you. One of the integration officer or lead is a Filipino. Now, regarding the Moodle, there are times, in my experience, there are times that we need to disconnect the students in using the internet. So we need to make sure that the Moodle will work within the internet, even without the internet access. However, there are times that I encountered problems kasi may mga dependent na plugins or resources that needs internet. So I want to know if there's a way to identify those resources and to make it locally stored in the server. So that's one option to make the loading of the Moodle site faster.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the use case. Do you mean that so the internet, so the Moodle, your Moodle set would be like only available locally in your school?
Yes, there are times we disable internet, especially if there is no internet connection, since the server is in the school and the computer laboratories are in the school, there's no need to use internet and to make the connection faster.
Well, I think that should make the connection faster. You don't really have to do anything if you're just accessing Moodle locally in your local network. I'm not sure what's going on if you're encountering problems. Maybe there are some, it could be like many reasons. Like, for example, you have a plugin that needs to connect to the internet or that needs external services, like SSO. Like, for example, you have Google authentication. It would need to connect to the internet. So if your site is not connected to the internet, then it won't be able to do so. So something like that.
Okay. So thank you. Another is regarding the icons you all mentioned. I appreciate that there are improvements in the icons. There are many forums I read about icons because there are some schools that wants to modify or have their customized icons. Now, my question or suggestion would be, is there a way to change the set of icons easier to upload some sets and then upload it once for to select set of icons? Because I experienced it myself, there is no option, so I don't have other options but to overwrite the icons folder to replace the default icons. So I'm just thinking if there's a way, a better interface, user experience, that you will upload customized icons at once for each of it, and then you select the uploaded or default.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. That's interesting. I'm not sure you can do it by default from the admin interface. All right. One thing you can do is to extend the boost theme and then upload your own icons there. Yeah.
Yes, that's it. But I'm hoping if there is like.
For now, no. Yeah. You can create a tracker issue and suggest an improvement.
Yes.
As much as possible, try to provide a lot of details for your use case, so we can consider working on it. Or alternatively, create a patch yourself and then contribute.
Yes, actually I'm thinking about developing one of the plugins maybe in the future. Yep. So thank you very much.
No worries. Thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. Any other question? All right, there being none, and it's in as much as you want to entertain your questions, you may post them on the Mood side. So once again, thank you very much, sir, and thank you also for raising our flag in the Moodle headquarters. A round of applause, please, for Mr. Jun Pataleta.